Now on for American Football, presented by Nicky Horn.
5 touchdowns.
Good evening. I hope you had a nice Christmas. Well, all will be revealed tonight as the NFL's regular season reaches its final week. Just like last week, we'll attempt to unravel the mysteries of the various playoff races as simply and comprehensively as possible. And later, John Smith will be focusing on the AFC, in particular, the New England Patriots against the Cincinnati Bengals, one of several key games in that conference. But first, it's the NFC, whose division winners we already knew. Dallas in the East, Chicago in the Central, the Los Angeles Rams in the West. Still in doubt was the destiny of the two wild cards, the three candidates being the New York Giants, Washington, and last year's champions, San Francisco. First to play were the Redskins and the Giants. Pittsburgh Steelers 10, New York Giants 28. The Giants made the playoffs thanks to their 5'7" running back, Joe Morris. Morris ran for 202 yards and three scores, this one with only one boot. And he ended the regular season with 21 touchdowns, more than anyone else in the league. The defeat for Pittsburgh meant that Cleveland were assured of the AFC Central. Washington Redskins 27, St. Louis Cardinals 16. What Joe Morris did for the Giants, George Rogers did for the Redskins. A club record 205 yards and one touchdown. While the Cardinals fired coach Jim Hannifin after the game, the Redskins had to wait for San Francisco to play Dallas to know their fate. Victory for San Francisco, and the Redskins would be out.
So, 24 hours later, it was all or nothing for the 49ers. And tonight, Dallas at San Francisco is our feature game. The Cowboys, already assured of their division, were without five of their regular starters, including number one quarterback Danny White. But if anyone thought the 49ers were in for an easy ride, they were soon mistaken. As we join it early in the first quarter, Dallas are on their opening drive and pressing hard. Our commentators, John Madden and Pat Summerall, first and 10 at the 49ers 16.
Here's Dorsett. He hammers down to about the 11. Ronnie Lott came up to hit him. Bill Walsh. It's been a long year for Bill. It's tough to defend, but it's been an injury-prone year and an up-and-down year for the 49ers of Walsh.
I know what Bill's thinking. You know, Bill Walsh is a real offensive coach, and the defense is just the thing to do until you get the ball back. He hasn't had the ball yet today.
Poe and Renfro, both wide right. Okaboom sprints out, fires for Poe, and fires a little high. Eric Wright, the defender.
It was interesting how all the players were saying how good a player Carl Poe is. In fact, Tony Dorsett says that this guy is only a rookie, he said, but he's going to be a star in this league. They give a lot of credit to that. They're giving a lot of credit to Drew Pearson, who, of course, was a Cowboy wide receiver who has been working with Poe.
Eric Wright, I don't think the 49er bench saw him. That's Drew Pearson. He was hurt on that last play. Finally, he was headed for the bench, and finally he heads back in on defense. He got hurt in practice day before yesterday. Now he doesn't know the defense. They're coming on a blitz. And they're coming. Newsom. Out of bounds inside the five by Ronnie Lott.
I'll tell you, that's the guy that they're going to have to block today. They're going to have to block Jeff Fuller. He's coming right here. You know, and he comes in, and just as Hogaboom gets rid of the ball, he gets hit. Watch Fuller right there. coming through Frey Foamy, hits him just as he throws the ball. Most of the time in that defense, they do blitz Jeff Fuller.
First and goal from the three. The Cowboys with two tight ends. They give to Dorsett. Penalty flag is down. Ricky Ellison made the hit. Dorsett stopped for perhaps a loss of one.
I think that's probably against the 49ers. I wonder if they lined up offsides again. That happens more in short yardage and goal line, because they want to get as low as they can and as much as the football as they can. Sometimes they line up in that neutral zone.
Matt Haggerty.
Offside, number 27, lined up in the neutral zone.
Lined up in the neutral zone, as you said. Carlton Williamson was the culprit.
Well, you usually think it's going to be a lineman or a linebacker, but in that case, it was a strong safety. Because when you get down to the goal line, that strong safety is also up on the line of scrimmage.
First down still. Hornwell in motion. They fake to Dorsett. They throw to Crosby, and there's nobody even in the picture. And it's touchdown, Cowboys. Hogaboom found Crosby all alone in the end zone, and the Cowboys get on the scoreboard first. Set the end. He lined it. Things didn't look just exactly correct on that extra point, but it was good, and Dallas leads 7-0.
Let's watch the touchdown again to Doug Crosby, and we'll see how he got so wide open. Here's Crosby here. Keenan Turner has to cover him here. Now watch the man in motion. He comes here. He's going to pick in here. Crosby then comes free out here. Now watch Crosby. He's the tight end. The motion man goes outside. Now watch as the motion man comes inside right there. See right there? He picks him, and that allows Crosby to get wide open.
That's back in Virginia, and those are members of the Washington Redskins. That's Keith Griffin in the middle. And who would have thought? Redskins rooting for Cowboys.
I bet they don't even know how to say it. I bet they can't say, "Come on, Cowboys!"
The Cowboys are still going well in the second quarter. Third and four at the 49ers' 30-yard line.
49ers on a blitz again, and Hogaboom fires outside complete to Timmy Newsom. Not really upset.
There's a flag down
flag
there,
down,
too.
Yes.
Looked like Ronnie Lott touched the official. You know, you don't have to hit him. If you just put a hand on those officials, that's going to be 15 yards, or it may be ejection from the game.
Personal foul on the defense.
They didn't say who it was.
I think the 49er defense thought it was an interception. Let's see right here. They thought that Hicks had the interception. Now the ball is down there. Hicks comes up with it, but it's out of bounds there.
First down.
I don't know about that one. Then Ronnie Lott was arguing about it. Watch Ronnie Lott there. See, he put his hands on the official.
Push him from the back, just at the corner of the picture.
I don't know that that was a reception, though. I don't know that they weren't right in their argument.
Well, Newsom had it. And then when he went down, the ball came loose, and Hicks came up with it. Whatever, it's first down, Dallas, inside the 15 of the 49ers. Hogaboom gives to Dorsett, and he spins down to about the 11. Wayne Board on the bottom. It's second down from the 12, and the pitch is back to Dorsett, and he's around the corner almost. But Ronnie Lott comes up quickly with an assist from Ricky Ellison. What looked like it was going to turn into probably and possibly a touchdown turned out to be nothing.
tell you, it sure did one thing. It sure fired Ronnie Lott up. You know, he's that fiery type of player anyway, you know, and a good tackler. And he's a defensive back, but he's about half linebacker in him. And he likes to get up there and get in that action and make those tackles.
Banks and Renfro are split to the left. Poe is off to the right. Here come the 49ers on that blitz. Boom lost it in the direction of Renfro. Dwight Hicks was right there with him, as close as you can get. Here at Candlestick, it's 7-0 Dallas over San Francisco in a game that the 49ers must win to get into the playoffs. Septy in with Hogaboom holding from about 30 yards out. Call it 29, just inside the 30. Septian is good, and it's 10-0 Dallas, and the Redskins love it. If Dallas can win, the Redskins will go to Giants Stadium next week to play the Giants. It's 10-0.
Three quick first downs took Dallas from deep inside their own half to the San Francisco 23-yard line on their next drive. First down and 10.
Hogaboom to work again, and going for Renfro. That was almost a touchdown, Cowboys. McLemore. Watch this move coming up.
Well, it's a post corner. Watch Renfro. He's down here at the bottom of the screen. He's going to start up. Then he'll start in to his right to the post. See, he goes there. See there? Now that gets a defender going in, McLemore. Then he turns back out. Then he flattens out. He's done it all so far. He's done all the move things. Perfect pass right in his hands, and he drops it. Maybe had he fallen down, he would have caught it.
Something else could have gone wrong.
Yeah. That was some move, though. The old post corner. Sell him on the post and run to the corner.
They're at the 49er 23. Hogaboom back, and here they come again, chasing Gary. And down he goes at the 30 in the hands of Tina Turner. They just didn't get him blocked. A loss of 8.
Tina Turner is one of those guys. He's right up here, just has great speed. He starts in here in the blitz. He's faster than Hogaboom now. Hogaboom starts here, he comes in, and he can run faster than Hogaboom can escape. Watch him come here. Watch that speed. Tina Turner's a linebacker, but he runs like a wide receiver.
So that'll make it 3rd and 17, back at the 30. Hogaboom back in the spread. And here they come after him again. Dorsett is open. He had 4 steps. That could have been 6.
But again, Hogaboom is hit. I'll tell you, every time Gary Hogaboom throws the ball, he's ending up on the ground. They're getting enough protection for him to get rid of the ball, but does he pay for it when he gets rid of it? Watch here. Fuller's coming from the outside. He gets knocked down. He gets pressure. There's Dwayne Board coming right up the middle. Fuller gets off his block and knocks him down.
And now Hogaboom has to stay in and hold for Raphael Septien's 48-yard attempt. It's a pretty impressive statistic. 22 straight on grass. Could be 23. Just got over the crossbar. It's good. And the Redskins are loving it back in Virginia.
Six minutes left in the second quarter. The Cowboys are going forward yet again with a 2nd and 10 at San Francisco's 25-yard line.
Here's Dorsett. Have to come up with that. And Hogaboom is up in a fracas with Tui Asisopo.
He'll lose that one.
That's a mismatch.
That's Michael Carter there. They finally got him off the field. He's probably as fired up about this game as anyone. Michael Carter, he's from Dallas. He was a Cowboy fan. He's the guy they want to run at and come off of him. Fred Dean was the guy who made the tackle. You see him? He made the tackle and got his hand in there and pulled the ball out on Dorsett. Keena Turner comes up with the fumble recovery.
So it's first down, San Francisco. Inside their 20, about the 17. Montana back to throw and fires complete to Clark. Michael Downs on the stop. That's about a yard short of a first down. San Francisco's first four possessions. Of course, they don't have any points. Interception, punt, punt, and a fumble. It's hard to get in the playoffs like that.
Well, it is, and they know. And Bill Walsh said the other day, if we don't beat the Cowboys, we don't deserve to get in the playoffs. I think the players feel that way, too. I know when Washington won yesterday, they all said they were happy. They said, because if we're going to be there, we want to win to get there.
I think, really, the reduction, the roster reduction from 49 to 45 probably had a bigger effect on the 49ers than any other team.
I would think so, because they use more players than any other team, both on offense and defense.
It really hurt them on special teams as well. Montana, 7 out of 13. Here's Craig. He only got a yard. Eugene Lockhart.
You know, one thing that they do so well and have over the years since they've had Roger Craig is hit him on those short possession underneath passes. I'm surprised so far that they really haven't gone to that. The Cowboy defense, when they're in their flex, is darn near impossible to run against. But it's always easier to throw some on first down.
That's the book on Craig. That's Russ Francis on the move. They get it out to Roger Craig, and that's the play you wanted. Jesse Penn gets him out of bounds. That'll bring up a third.
That's an interesting thing about that play that they did, is they were trying to run a real pick. They were trying to come in and block the guy. Watch Russ Francis. He's going to come in here and try and block the linebacker and get Craig to the outside. You see the motion man comes in. That's Russ Francis. He's going to block right there, try and get the guy who's supposed to cover Craig. Then he comes out in his pattern, and they want to get Craig free on the loop.
That might be slightly illegal.
Yeah, I don't know. I said interesting. I don't know if it's legal or not. It's interesting.
Montana gets it to Rice. Covered by Walls, but it's across midfield. A gain of 14.
These are the things that they feel that they had to do. They have to get the ball to Rice, especially if they're going to blitz. Walls tried to get him, get that right hand up there to bring him in. You know, a defender will do that. Get that right hand in the jersey, then that'll bring you into the pattern, but Rice still got by him.
Rice wide to the left this time. Montana back to throw with time. He's got a man wide open. That's White Clark, and that's no contact. Touchdown pass from Montana to Clark. That's a combination that Cowboys will remember.
That was the pattern that the 49ers worked on all day. They call it the shake pattern. It's a post. He starts a post, then he goes to the corner, then he goes back to the post. It's post, corner, post. They call it a shake. They worked on that all week.
Ray Wershing with Kavanaugh holding makes it 13-7. 3:54 left in the first half at Candlestick.
Usually it's two things. You watch Dwight Clark up on top. You go post, then corner. Here they go post. See post? Now back corner again. Now back post again. You see what it did to Victor Scott? He said that's the old post corner. Scott started to run to the corner. Dwight Clark gave him one more move.
He ran a great pattern, didn't he? 13-7.
So the 49ers back in it. But on their next drive, the Cowboys once again got into field goal range, and Raphael Septien's 41-yarder gave them a 16-7 lead with just 32 seconds of the first half to play. San Francisco's ball, first and 10 at their own 31-yard line.
They got three wide receivers out wide to the right. Montana looks left, however, and he's got rights. And he's got speed. And a lot of it. And very intelligently, he gets out of bounds. 23 seconds left to play in the first half, a gain of 31.
That's the old thing, you know, you get all the guys out on this side, the three out here, make you think you're coming here, and then get your one-on-one and work it back to this side. That's what the 49ers did on that play. They had the three over there, Jerry Rice, back here, Singleton. See, they got him single. Oh, they should have kept him going straight up.
Now they have the three wideouts lined up, one behind the other. That's Tutall Jones and Randy White meet at the quarterback. The second time Montana's been sacked. Now they call another timeout.
Here they got that same formation again. I bet they go to the left side this time though.
Montana goes quickly in that direction and got Rice quickly. Inside the 40 to about the 38. They have one more timeout left. A gain of 14. And they took it.
Well, since their last timeout, they had the three wide receivers on this side. Rice over here, this time again against Victor Scott. Now instead of going deep, he goes up and then boom, comes in on the slam. Gets the ball about the 35, 34. Now right there, that'd be a 51-yard field goal. This is what the other side looked like. One, two, three. Lined up. The Cowboys are lining up on there. Now what they do is they're going to bump the first two. That's a smart thing.
11 seconds left. Dallas leading 16-7. There's Ray Worshing. From right here, as you said, John, it would be 51 yards. And that's about maximum for him.
Well, you know, he's trying to keep his head down. He's also trying to not think of what happened last week. Last week against New Orleans, they had one block just before the half for a touchdown.
How'd you like to go through life with your head down?
It depends on what you are. Like if you're, you know, hunting for gophers or playing golf, it's good.
Quick pass outside of Francis. Francis got him in range. Now watch Worshing when he comes onto the field, if we can. He never looks up.
What he does, though, is he looks at those hash marks. Because if you go straight down the hash marks are the same width as the goalpost. But the goalposts, you're a lot farther away, and they look a lot more narrow. So he won't look up at them.
This is going to be from just inside the 30, so make it 39 yards for Worshing. He says to his holder when he first comes onto the field, while he's not looking up, help me, help me. Worshing is down the pipe with no time left. He makes it 16-10. That's the end of the half. A good first half. And the score is Dallas 16, San Francisco 10. A game that means everything to the 49ers and to those guys, the Redskins.
The Cowboys are on their first drive of the third quarter. First and 10 at their own 44-yard line.
Ogerboom rolls right. Got good protection. Pass is picked off by Dwight Hicks. Hicks by Fowler. But the 49ers have it in Dallas territory.
Big play for the 49er defense. I'm sure those Redskin guys are thinking, why, when you're having so much success working on the other side, why work against the veteran? Why go to the right side? Dwight Hicks is just sitting there waiting for that one. We see the motion. We see a zone defense. See Hicks, the outside guy, just backs up, reads a quarterback, looks in, gets a good jump, jumps in front of the ball, and gets the interception. I don't think Hogaboom read that as a zone defense.
He was trying to go to Cosby. Montana has him at the Dallas 44. He should go right to work to Craig, and he does. And Craig hammers for about 9. inside the 35, stopped by Dennis Thurman. There's good for nine, second and one. They give again to Trey. Trey is to the Dallas 30 before Jesse Penn gets him down with an assist from Eugene Lockhart. Craig already over 1,000 rushing.
This has been a big week for Roger Craig. He won the Len Eshman Award. That's the players, you know, picking the best player and the most inspirational player. He won that this week. He won the starter in the Pro Bowl this week. And his wife is having a baby this week any day.
And what an enthusiastic individual he is. He enjoys playing this game. Montana has some time. And he has Francis, who juggled it but held on at the Dallas 20. Walls and Scott, a gain of eight.
You know, it's funny how you go to training camp and you go through the four preseason, 16 regular season, and for these 49ers, it all boils down to one more half a play. Either they get it in this half and they go on, or they don't and the season's over.
This, indeed, is the playoffs for them. 9:45 left third quarter. Craig, the lone setback. And they give it to him. Maybe one, but maybe enough for the first down. It's going to be close. Randy White made the tackle.
I think that's one of the things Bill Walsh decided at halftime. We have to get the ball more to Roger Craig. In the first half, he only carried it six times and caught two passes. He only had his hands on the ball eight times. I think when you look at that at halftime, you look at those stats, you say, he's the hottest player we have. We have to get him the ball.
And they've certainly been doing it in this drive. First down, 49ers. Bill Walsh and backup quarterback Matt Kavanaugh. He just put John Frank in the game. Fun horse. Having some work done on his hand. 49er trainer hustled out there while they were measuring, and now hustles off. Veteran Keith Funhorst playing with that mask on. Got a finger in the eye. Seeing more and more of that. Pitch out to Craig. He got 3 yards on Desire. Dutton and Hegman out there to make the stop.
I think the Cowboy defense, when they're in their regular defense or flex, probably plays that type of thing, you know, that toss or sweep as well as anyone. And there's the guy that coaches him, Ernie Stotner. He's calling in the signals there, telling them what to do, sending in four guys, taking out four guys. It's like mass confusion.
They're back in the 4-0 now with all the defensive backs. Montana gets it down to Francis inside the 10, inside the 5 he is. Dexter Clinchgale got him down. A gain of 13 to the tight end, Russ Francis.
That's the thing you do with your tight end. It's a crossing pattern. We'll see a play pass. Here comes Francis across. Clinchgale was on him man-to-man. Francis just beat him by a couple steps. But the play pass holds him, holds the linebackers. Then you can sneak your tight end in there behind him.
Plus, Francis runs that pattern as close as he can to that umpire.
He uses the umpire as a shield on that play.
First and goal at the 4. Bill Ring is in the game with Craig. Craig fighting and gets into the end zone. Eugene Lockhart made the stop, but Roger Craig carried him into the end zone. Touchdowns this year for Roger Craig.
Now, Roger Craig doesn't look like a strong guy, but he sure was on that play.
Wershing with Kavanaugh holding. The 49ers for the first time today take the lead.
Watch Roger Craig right here at the end. Eugene Lockhart, number 56, is going to meet him about the 2-yard line. Watch there. Watch Craig. Right there, now about the 2-yard line. Drive, 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 drive. He takes Lockhart right into the end zone with him. And Lockhart's a strong guy. Watch where this contact starts here. 56 hits him there. And watch those legs. That leg's like up there. Boom, boom, boom.
The 49ers in front for the first time. And towards the end of the third quarter, they have the ball again.
Montana and the 49ers have the ball at the Cowboy 46. First down. He gets it out quickly to Craig. Faced by Downs. And finally shoved out of bounds by Downs.
Yeah, we were talking about Roger Craig and how he works. He never takes a day off. On their day off, he comes in and he works out. He's there every day. And then even during practice, when he runs a play, he runs it 50 yards. I mean, runs every play 50 yards.
No huddle. 49ers go quickly. Montana goes back quickly. Gets it out to Craig, chased by Lockhart. And now he is... Roger Craig has done something that no one else has ever done in the history of the NFL. He's gotten over 1,000 yards rushing and over 1,000 yards receiving. The first player in the history of this game to do it. 1,023 running, 1,012 receiving. And going for more in the hopes of these 49er fans. Francis in motion. Derek Harmon straight ahead for a couple. Stopped by Lockhart. That truly is a remarkable, remarkable feat. And that is not all that Roger Craig can do.
Well, you know, he catches the passes, he runs. Watch how he blocks on this play. 33, he's the fullback. It's going to be a crossing action. Watch, he's going to come in there on Jim Jeffcoat. Boom, he just cuts Jeffcoat down, and then Harmon runs to the inside. Good players do it all. There's no great one-dimensional player.
Second and six. Outside it is to Craig, faced by Lockhart. He slipped down at the 15. Gain of four. It'll bring up a third down situation. He's a guy that sort of lights up the place.
Well, he does. You know, I mean, he lights up the place when he's sitting around in a meeting room. And, you know, in practice, I couldn't believe it, but just on a Friday practice, he'll take the ball and they run a dummy scrimmage and he runs it 50 yards.
He runs as far as he can go.
And then he runs back and does it again. He only knows one way to go.
It's a good thing they got a fence around the field. A reverse coming to Rice. Rice is faced by Jeffcoat and that's a mismatch. Rice inside the 15, touchdown. Mississippi Valley State, and he is everything they thought he would be and more when they took him number one. Pershing with the extra point. 24-16 San Francisco.
Let's watch that play. Rice is here. You start to flow this way, and he comes back here. But now watch about right here, the block he's going to get from number 81, Russ Francis, that breaks him. See, what you do is you start to flow both backs this way. Here comes Rice, handed there. Now he gets away from Jeffcoat right up here. And now watch down about the five-yard line. Coming into the picture now, there's Russ Francis. He gets that last block he needs that gets Rice into the end zone.
3 minutes into the fourth quarter, 8 points behind, the Cowboys decide to gamble on a fourth down and one.
The give is to Newsom, and I don't know if he got it or not. Well, if he wasn't down, he's not going to get it.
Get down low. There was no surge going to the right. It was right there. There was no movement. There was nothing. The 49er line was right there. John Hardy was the guy that Newsom ran into. Hardy knocked him backwards, and Landry says, oh, no.
So the 49ers take over with 11 and a half minutes remaining in the fourth. San Francisco out and ready. First down, 49ers with their own 39. Rice wide left. And Montana looking for Russ Francis, who has it. Chased by Jeff Rohr. Knocked out of bounds by Clinkscale. Put into Dallas territory. A gain of 13.
I don't know if Clinkscale knocked Francis out of bounds or if Francis went out of bounds and then knocked Clinkscale. But Francis, he's going to be here. I think he goes out of bounds because he's out right now. And then doink. Never did go down.
No. First and 10. Montana back to throw. And going for Rice, and he's got him if he can get there. Victor Scott running with him, but Rice was pulling away. He is going to be a great receiver. Barring injury, he's going to be one of the best to ever play.
Hey, you know, you talk about speed. Any guy that can run has two or three gears. You have one gear to get open, then you have another gear to separate or run by. Watch Rice separate from Victor Scott. That's a pretty big separation there. Had the ball just been just an inch less, that would have been a touchdown.
He almost ran away from his own towel. Second and 10. Craig straight ahead for about four. Inside the Dallas 45, Don Smirick on the bottom of the pile. Jeffcoat there as well.
Yeah, the 49ers have taken a lot of heat, and Joe Montana's taken a lot of heat, but really, football isn't consistent like it was last year. With all this blitzing and the defenses we see and going after them and penetration, it's hard to be that consistent quarterback. Joe Montana is still the statistical leader, still the Pro Bowl quarterback.
Bill Walsh said it all revolves around Joe. Here's Randy White chasing Joe, and Joe's out of the pocket, and he gets it to Rice. Rice is tripped up by Wall. But he gets down inside the Dallas 25.
Hey, Joe Montana made that play on his escape because Randy White had him. Randy White had him with no blocker on him, coming right into him. But Montana always escapes to his right. Watch him. He feels the pressure there now. He does it. Now he runs out to the right and zoom, completes that pass. How many times have you pictured Joe Montana scrambling out to his right and completing a big pass?
If I were against him, I'd rather him stay in the pocket. Montana for Clark. Touchdown.
What an adjustment by Dwight Clark on that play, Pat. He was looking over his left shoulder, then he had to come back and catch the ball over his right.
Clark has caught five passes for 99 yards and two touchdowns. Worshing for the extra point, and it's good. Let's watch that pattern.
Well, it was the same type of pattern that he ran earlier, but it was thrown over his outside shoulder. Watch him here. He's going to start in. He's going to run up the field. Then he'll give him a move to the inside post. Now back to the corner. Now he's going to go back again. Now watch him. It's over that shoulder. Now he turns his head and catches it over the inside shoulder. That was a post corner, and then it ended up in one more little move.
One more adjustment probably is better than a move at the end because Montana threw the ball to the inside. Boy, that's a familiar pose, isn't it?
There was no more scoring. Final score, Dallas 16, San Francisco 31. And no question there were signs there of the old 49ers. By virtue of their two wins against both the Giants and the Redskins, Dallas still took the NFC East. The Giants pipped the Redskins for one wild card because of their superior record within the division.
And the 49ers took the other wild card ahead of the Redskins because they beat Washington once this year. Meanwhile, the champions of the NFC West, the Los Angeles Rams, ended their regular season disappointingly against their rivals from the other side of town, the LA Raiders.
In the fourth quarter of an otherwise unmemorable game, Marcus Allen completed his ninth consecutive 100-yard rushing game and became the leading rusher for the season with 1,759 yards. The only touchdown came 3.5 minutes before the end.
Third down, long three, and Wilson is back. What's it all? Jesse Williams is there. Touchdown.
Final score, Los Angeles Raiders 16, Los Angeles Rams 6. We'll come back to the Raiders and the AFC shortly. Just to finish off the NFC, there's one more score from the West. Atlanta Falcons 16, New Orleans Saints 10. And from the Central Division, Green Bay Packers 20, Tampa Bay Buccaneers 17, Philadelphia Eagles 37, Minnesota Vikings 35. Vikings kicker Jan Stenerud, at 43, the oldest player in the league, announced his retirement before the game. Chicago Bears 37, Detroit Lions 17. The Bears' 15th win of the season, and the refrigerator, William Perry, added another feather to his cap by returning a fumble 59 yards to set up the Bears' final touchdown. So Chicago take the Central Division by 7 games, from Green Bay, with Minnesota and Detroit a further game back. And now the complete NFC playoff picture looks like this. San Francisco are at the New York Giants in the wild card game. The winner of that will be at Chicago in one divisional game. Dallas are at the Los Angeles Rams in the other. Well, later I'll be giving you a full rundown of what you can see when here on Channel 4. But now let's turn to the AFC, where the Eastern Division was between Miami, the New York Jets, and New England. Cleveland were sure of the Central Division after Pittsburgh's loss to the Giants. And the Raiders were winners in the West, with Denver still in the wild card chase. To stay in that chase, Denver had to win their last game at Seattle.
Denver Broncos 27, Seattle Seahawks 24. The Broncos trailed 17-0 in the first half and 24-17 with 5 minutes to go. But quarterback John Elway made sure they pulled through in the end. He completed 24 of 42 passes for 432 yards, and this 60-yard strike to Steve Watson was the key play in the drive that led to the tying touchdown. Rich Carlos's 43-yard field goal decided it, 55 seconds from time.
Denver still alive, ending their season one game behind the Raiders on 11-5. Seattle finished disappointingly on 8-8. One other result from this division, San Diego Chargers 34, Kansas City Chiefs 38. The Chiefs' Stephen Page caught 8 passes for 309 yards, a new NFL record. Well, attention now switched to the AFC East, and Miami, the New York Jets, and New England. If all three won, they'd all be through to the playoffs. Miami as division winners, the Jets and New England as wild cards. If any of them slipped up, one of those wild cards would go to Denver.
Buffalo Bills 0, Miami Dolphins 28. Not one of Miami's greatest displays, but more than enough to win them the division for the third year running. Dan Marino threw for only 136 yards, but two of his 15 completions were for touchdowns to tight end Bruce Hardy, and two rushing touchdowns in the final quarter gave the score a far more realistic look. The first went to Tony Nathan. The second to Ron Davenport. Cleveland Browns 10, New York Jets 37. The Jets were 7-3 down when quarterback Ken O'Brien threw this pass straight to Browns safety Don Rogers, but out popped the ball and in ran Kurt Sohn for the Jets' first touchdown. They scored 3 more touchdowns in what turned out to be an easy win, 2 of them going to running back Johnny Hector.
So Miami and the Jets into the playoffs with little bother. Next up were the New England Patriots, whose final game was at home to the Cincinnati Bengals. John Smith reports now from New England, with fingers crossed for his old team.
Nicky, the big question here is, have the Patriots recovered from that big defeat in Miami last week? In particular, quarterback Tony Eason, who was so crucially intercepted in the final minute. Overall, they're a far better team than Cincinnati, even if the Bengals are the third highest scorers in the NFL. But I think the Patriots' defense will take care of them. I certainly hope so.
In the early stages, the two teams exchanged field goals. So as we join the first quarter, it's 3-3, and the Patriots have a second and six at their own 25-yard line.
Sweep this side, Collins, across the 30-yard line. He's into the Bengals' secondary, and he is pulled down from behind by James Griffin. Collins rambles for 30, make that 27 yards.
Tony Collins has been used primarily as a receiver coming out of the backfield, but they're running a sweep, and watch him use his blockers and wait for the crack. And there's the crack. John Hanna can get through, so can you, Tony. And now watch him put added yardage on it as James Griffin makes the tackle. And I believe the Patriots today are going to try to run the football right at Cincinnati.
From the midfield stripe at his first down. Play action, Eason. Looking long. He will air it out. Touchdown number five this season. His 47th career TD. That, my friends, is a team record here in New England.
Early in the second quarter, the Bengals reduced the deficit to 4 points when Jim Breach kicked his second field goal. Now the Patriots have the ball again, second and 10 at the Bengals' 44.
Here comes James. Fumbles the football. The Bengals have it, and they can go all the way. Reggie Williams with the hit. Xander picked up the loose football and carried it all the way to the 16-yard line. Eason, the guy who knocked him out of bounds.
Now here's James now breaking through. Now Reggie Williams makes the tackle, and that's why that ball is shaped that way. Look how it bounces right up in the hands of Carl Xander. Now he just wished he had another gear. If he would have had another gear, he would have had a touchdown, because that was the quarterback that knocked him out of bounds.
Xander, a rookie out of volunteer land. He gives the Bengals new life with that 34-yard fumble return. First and 10 Cincinnati at the Patriots 16. 8:03 to play, first half. Esiason looking right, now looking back to the left. It is intercepted. Ronnie LaPet. So the Bengals, employing the true meaning of this holiday season, being that it is better to give than to receive, have given the ball up to the Patriots at the 30-yard line.
After those turnovers, the Patriots inch towards the Bengals' end zone. They now have a second and goal at the 9.
Touchdown, Patriots! Touchdown run for Tony Collins, and it's a play, Sam Natigliano, that has been around football for as long as I've been around.
It was a misdirected play. They went to James on the right. Collins came to the left for touchdown, and that interception just cost them cost Cincinnati 7 points.
Tony Franklin's second field goal increased the Patriots' lead, and at halftime they led 20-6. But on their first drive of the third quarter, the Bengals hit back.
There's Brooks in motion on 3rd and 9. It is caught, Eddie Brown, for the 5, touchdown Cincinnati. As we said a moment ago at halftime, this Bengal offense has quick strike capability, and you saw it right there.
This is a quick slant. Watch Boomer. 1, 2, 3. Deliver the ball right between the linebackers. And now watch Eddie Brown's athletic ability. He can catch the football and accelerate. And Raymond Claiborne could not keep him out of the end zone. And now it's 20-13.
3 minutes into the fourth quarter, another breach field goal made it 20-16. But the Patriots were soon on the move again. Stanley Morgan's catch was good for 48 yards, and the Patriots now have a 3rd and 4 at the Bengals' 11-yard line.
Backwards pass. James. Will he score? Touchdown, Patriots!
Twenty-7-16 to the Patriots, but the Bengals weren't finished yet.
Second down and goal, Cincinnati, 5:49 to play in the ball game. Esiason, he throws, touchdown, Collinsworth.
Watch Boomer right now. He's going to wait for Collinsworth to break himself open. He gets good rebound position in the end zone, and that's Raymond Claiborne, outstanding receiver. Chris Collinsworth. It's just like being under a basket on the goal line. You get good rebound position and you deliver the ball for a touchdown.
So now the Patriots were under pressure. They have a 4th down and 1 at the Bengals' 42-yard line.
Could easily be the biggest play of the 1985 season for the New England Patriots. Tatupu and Weathers, the running backs. That's Weathers. Not only does he have the first down, you can chalk up a touch for New England. It was Robert Weathers on 4th down and 6 inches. Take a look as he bounces to the outside, and he is gone.
Cincinnati 23, New England 34. Celebration time for the Patriots. Here in the Patriots' locker room, away from all the mayhem outside, it's incredibly quiet. There's a feeling that I've felt before in this very locker room, one of contentment at a job well done. John, we've been in this position together before. Now you're in the playoffs again, you lucky son of a gun.
Yeah, John, why aren't you with us? You know, what happened to you, man? You aren't so old you can't kick.
Must be a great feeling, John.
It is. You know, it's a lot of fun. You know how it is. Everybody's excited. You got a chance, but it's a one-week life. You know, from now on out, it's just you got life for 1 week, and you got to do it every week.
How tough was it for this team to come back after that tough game in Miami?
Well, I think it was Thursday or Friday, really, before. I know it was Friday before I got it off my mind, and it was very emotional. We put a lot of emphasis on the ball game, and to come out short was really tough on us, and yet we knew that this was it. It all came down to this week, which today was a bigger game than Miami.
Well, this is a different Patriot team than we've ever been. I think our defense has a lot of confidence in itself. Later part of the season, the offense has really kind of taken control. And, you know, I'm sitting here, I'm a Patriot. I got to believe we can do it.
This year,
the whole key to our season has been our head coach. And, you know, I think the credit, he won't accept any of it, but it all goes to him. You know, he's brought us together. He's brought the young players and the old players together. He's given us a purpose, and it's much easier to play and to fight for a cause than it is for yourself. And in that respect, I think it's different, John.
You must be a very satisfied man right now.
Well, someone asked me about that, and the fact we're 11-5 in the playoffs and how I feel about it. I said, well, on one hand, I'm not surprised. I thought this team would do that. On the other hand, now that it's happened, it's incredulous.
Is it a different feeling making it this far as a player than a coach? You've done it both ways.
It is different, yeah. Coaching is 1,000 times harder than playing. If that's a fair mathematical appraisal of it, is no comparison. Playing the game is simple, John, to coaching it.
You know, we deserve to be here. And the thing is, we can beat anybody left. You know, we played everybody in the conference, that, you know, and we can beat anybody, and we got a chance.
So the Patriots join Miami and the New York Jets in the playoffs. Denver, who also had 11 wins in the West, miss out because of their inferior record against teams within the conference. One last result to give you from Week 16. Houston Oilers 16, Indianapolis Colts 34. Houston propping up the AFC Central. Cleveland winning it and becoming the first team to win a division with a record as poor as 8-8. So to complete the full AFC playoff picture, New England visit the New York Jets in the wild card game. The winner of that is at the LA Raiders in one divisional game. The Cleveland Browns are at the Miami Dolphins in the other. Well, now let me tell you about our playoff coverage here on Channel 4. This coming Wednesday, New Year's morning at 11, the wild card games. And don't forget, they're followed by baseball at 12:30. Next Sunday at 6 o'clock, the first pair of divisional games. Dallas at the LA Rams, Cleveland at Miami. Sunday, January the 12th at 6, the second pair of divisional games. The NFC wild card winner at Chicago, the AFC wild card winner at the LA Raiders. Sunday, January the 19th at 6, the conference championship games, the Super Bowl semi-finals. And finally, of course, on Sunday, January the 26th, from 9:30 in the evening, Super Bowl 20, live from New Orleans. Any more clues about who's going to be in New Orleans? Well, let me tell you this. The Chicago Bears are already doing their Super Bowl shuffle. I'll see you on Wednesday morning at 11. Until then, good night.
We are the Bears, shuffling crew, shuffling on down, doing it for you. We're so bad, we know we're good, blowing your mind like a new game will. You know we're just strutting for fun, strutting our stuff for everyone. We're not here to start no trouble, we're just here to do the Super Bowl shuffle.
Well, they call me Sweetness, and I like to dance. Running the ball is like Mickey Mouse Mans. We had the goal since training camp to give Chicago a Super Bowl champ. And we're not doing this because we're greedy. The Bears are doing it to beat the needy. We didn't come here to look for trouble. We just come here to do the Super Bowl shuffle.
This is Speedy Willis, and I'm world class. I like running, but I love to get the pass. I practice all day and dance all night. I gotta get ready for the Sunday fight. Now, I'm as smooth as a chocolate swirl. I dance a little funky, so watch me, girl.
You're looking at the fridge, I'm the Richie. I may be lost, but I'm no dumb cookie. You see me hit, you see me run. When I kick your pass, we'll have more fun. I can dance, you will see. The others, they all learn from me. I didn't come here looking for trouble. I just came to do Super Bowl shuffle.